I do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. In 1775, the son of a wealthy Virginia landowner, a gentleman farmer who had served 7 years as a colonel in the British Army, was appointed by the Continental Congress to be the commander-in-chief of the Colonial Army. George Washington was to lead 300,000 untrained, ill-equipped citizen soldiers against the armies of Great Britain.
From Bunker Hill to Yorktown, 6 long years, they fought, retreated, turned, and fought again. Island, Princeton, Trenton, Saratoga, saw the fighting hearts of freedom-loving men. From Bunker Hill to Yorktown, 6 long years, one gallant phrase kept ringing in their ears.
I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.
And they finished up at Yorktown with a mighty will what they started up on Bunker Hill.
The Revolutionary War had been fought. The victory won, and General Washington returned to his wife Martha at Mount Vernon to resume farming. But the new nation he had helped to create couldn't spare him. The country seethed with unrest. Congress was without leadership or power. Its paper money worth next to nothing, while tariffs brought trade between the states to a standstill. As Washington sadly wrote to a friend, "There are combustibles in every state which a spark might set fire to." He attended the Constitutional Convention as a delegate from Virginia, but his reputation and prestige made him its natural presiding officer. After months of heated debate and prolonged argument, a new form of government began to emerge, and men of conflicting opinions looked to George Washington for leadership.
First in war, first in peace, first in the hearts of his countrymen.
Washington, who favored a strong central government controlled by wealthy, educated men, nevertheless scorned Alexander Hamilton's proposal that a monarchy be established with a titled nobility. He stood staunchly behind the new Constitution, and the states, which feared the strong central power embodied in the Constitution, placed their faith in the integrity of a man. In 1789, George Washington, by unanimous vote of the electors, was chosen to be the first president of the United States. Everything in his administration was a first in American history. He appointed the first cabinet, Thomas Jefferson, Alexander Hamilton, Henry Knox, and Edmund Randolph. The first new states, Vermont, Kentucky, and Tennessee, were admitted to the Union. The Supreme Court met for the first time. The National Mint was established. The first census taken and the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, were adopted. Washington served for 2 consecutive terms. An infant nation groped for identity, and as her parent, Washington faced all the hardships and outrages of political fortune. He was called tyrant and accused of injustices and imprudence. The beginning of a two-party political system made him the target of every ambitious politician. It was with a sense of relief that George Washington saw his 8 years in the presidency come to an end. Now, at last, he could retire to Mount Vernon. He had given his life to his country and guided her first faltering footsteps to the path of greatness. In December of 1799, he caught a cold that developed into a high fever. As was the custom of the day, the doctors bled him. And knowing the end was near, Washington spoke his last words. "I thank you for your attention. You had better not take any more trouble about me, but let me go quietly." The news went out, and everywhere people wept. Throughout the young country, the nation mourned the loss of its father.
First in war, first in peace, first in the hearts of his countrymen, the father.